Well, happy Independence Day weekend. Happy Independence Day if you happen to be watching this on Saturday, or if it's any other day, happy birthday, America. I'm thankful for America and grateful for all those who have fought for freedom and to allow us to be able to worship freely. Even though we're restricted right now in terms of being together, we still can worship freely in our country. And I thank God for that. Thank God for technology that allows us to have this kind of interaction at least. And I hope you're enjoying these video services that we've been offering. We're regrouping a bit on meeting in person, as I referenced in a recent email, and waiting to see about restarting to do so at a safe time and a time that is right for us. As I'm sure you know, if you live in our area, that our two counties are trending in the wrong direction right now, and the health department is backing off on even asking for phase two. And we had thought things would start, we're starting to move the other direction, so we had planned to restart. But in any case, we're still believing that will be soon and hoping for that. And either way, we just hope you're being blessed right now. Today's video is going to be simple. There won't be a worship segment or some of the other things that we have. We'll go back to that next week more than likely, but and I'll explain a little bit about why that is in my message as I get rolling here. But I just wanted you to be aware that you didn't miss anything. We're getting right into it right now. So let me start right into my message today, which is from 1 Samuel chapter 30, and the title of it is "We Will See a Victory." We will see a victory. Imagine you come home from work one day, and as you drive toward your home, you look and you see smoke rising from the place where your house is, and you get closer and realize that your house has been completely burned to the ground. And not just that, as bad as that would be, but then you realize also that your family, your spouse and your children are also missing, and nobody has any idea where they are at this moment. How devastating would that be to go through that? And you understand that maybe you begin to get information that your wife and children had been, or your spouse and children had been kidnapped. And so that may sound as intense and crazy to you or to me, and honestly, it is, but that's exactly what happened in our story here in 1 Samuel chapter 30 to David and his men. So you know, the devil has a job description in the Bible, and it is to steal, to kill, and destroy, and he sticks with that MO all the time. And this story in 1 Samuel is an example of that modus operandi of the devil to do those things. So David had been anointed as king, you remember, when he was younger, but Saul was still in that position. David had to flee Saul, who was trying to kill him, and he was wandering around in the desert, and sure enough, he gathered a group of men around him, and they numbered about 600 men, and then their wives and their families became this kind of entourage, if you will, that wandered about in the desert of the Sinai Peninsula. And so David, you know, this is how his life was for many years. And so he used to go off into these battles. He was still fighting for Israel, even though he was kind of banished for Israel, but he was still fighting for Israel and protecting Israel as a king would, even though he didn't sit on the throne at that point. Well, in any case, he had been away on battles, many battles, and he and his men, to get home to their town, which was Ziklag, they had to travel 3 days' journey to get there. And when they get there, that's when they discover this devastation that we're going to read about from 1 Samuel chapter 30, verses. We'll start with verses 1 through 6, and we'll actually go through many parts of this chapter as we go through, but let's start with verses 1 through 6. Here we go. David and his men reached Ziklag on the third day. Now the Amalekites had raided the Negev and the Ziklag. They had attacked Ziklag and burned it, and they had taken captive the women and everyone else in it, both young and old. They killed none of them, but carried them off as they went on their way. When David and his men reached Ziklag, they found it destroyed by fire, and their wives and their sons and daughters taken captive. So David and his men wept aloud until they had no strength left to weep. David's two wives had been captured, Ahinoam of Jezreel and Abigail, the widow of Nabal of Carmel. David was greatly distressed because the men were talking of stoning him. Each one was bitter in spirit because of his sons and daughters, but David found strength in the Lord his God. Let's pray. Lord, as we come to your word today, I just pray that you'll speak to us about the victory that you have, the ultimate victory. Lord, we face battles, we face hard times, we face difficulties, but I pray that you will encourage each heart as people listen to this message, whenever they listen to it in the future, God. We thank you for that. In Jesus Christ's name, amen, amen. So, let me start out. I just want to say, I don't want to sound whiny today. My problems and issues aren't much compared with some of the things that others are facing. Even as you think about this story of what David and his men faced, my problems are nothing compared to that. But my problems are still problems. Let's just say it that way. And I'm sure you feel the same way. So last week, Rhonda and I went on vacation. Now, you know, maybe, some would say, well, you shouldn't be traveling, and maybe you're right. I don't know. We went to Oregon where things are much more relaxed, and the purpose of our visit was to go to and to celebrate the 60th anniversary of Rhonda's mom and dad. And this had been a trip that had been planned for a couple of years, and all of our kids had time off during this time. And since things in terms of the virus were real light in the area we were going to, we felt like it was something that was safe to do, and we were careful about it and all that. But in any case, we went and we had an amazing time. Let me show you a picture right now of my kids singing with their kids, singing to mom and dad as they celebrated that with family members all around. It was quite a blessing. Well, I had made a video of their life, and my three sons, Andrew, Alex, and Abraham, sang to them the song, The Blessing. What an amazing song that is. But as you can see in that picture at the end, they all joined them and sang, may his favor be upon you through and a thousand generations, your family and your children and their children and their children. Now, thankfully for me, I was at the back mixing the sound and while everybody else was up front. And it's good that I was in the back because I was an absolute mess. I was a wreck. As I looked at my own children and grandchildren and my wife, and you see, four generations counting mom and dad there, it's amazing. It's really amazing. And so I was breaking down like a little baby in the back, and I'm not ashamed to admit it. But it was a pretty special time and a really wonderful visit. And not only that, I got to visit with my brother. We got the whole Damari family clan, except for one, together on the West Coast here. And I'm telling you, it was just an amazing time. And for a short while, I'd forgotten that there was any virus or anything wrong in the world. It just was a beautiful time of being away and enjoying family. So anyway, on Monday of this last week, while I was still on vacation, I made the mistake of checking my email on my home computer. I have a way to remote in. And when I did that, I opened my computer at my desk in my office here at the church and come to find out that I had been hijacked by ransomware. Now, if you're not familiar with ransomware, normally they try to attack big corporations and they can encrypt your files so that you can't recover them under any circumstances without their key. And so they try to sell you the key, and big corporations have had to pay a lot of money. Now, I don't know how I got targeted, if it was just a random thing. I don't have any money to give them, nor would I ever do so. But my computer was attacked, and for that matter, every file that was on it is not accessible to me. And so, come Monday, going into Tuesday, driving home, this is just in my mind, and I'm just like, oh man, what a terrible thing. And I'm thinking of, I didn't do a good job of backing up all my files. Most of them I have that are documents, but some pictures and videos I've lost, some of my documents I've lost. And it was just frustrating. And, it's just, you think, why do people do things like that? It's the world we live in. And so I was just frustrated Tuesday, got back Wednesday, kind of went into a tech support session with a friend of mine who's brilliant when it comes to computers. And he walked me through it for hours. We spent 24 hours looking for more solutions. Finally, on Thursday, decided there was nothing we could do but unplug the computer, set it over in the corner of the room, and start fresh. Well, that was just so much more than I wanted to face this week. But I looked forward to this weekend thinking, hey, but we're going to restart church. We're going to get together. We're going to be together with the family of God. And so I was encouraging myself in the fact that even though a lot of my time was going to be spent on dealing with computers, we were going to get to have a live service. So I So I was excited about all that, but as time went on, we got to Thursday, we began to hear that a family in our church had contracted the virus, that they'd had some interactions with some other people. We don't think there was, that the virus spread to others, but there was enough people that had been touched by that we began to back off on our plans. So here we are on video land once again, and I got to the place, to be honest with you, Thursday night, where I was kind of discouraged, I was despondent. It was like, and again, my problems may seem like nothing to the things you're facing, and I understand that, but man, when you face things like this, it's really disappointing. And, here's the thing, I guess, why it was so troubling to me, because as a pastor, you feel kind of an unsaid or unspoken pressure, I guess, to always get it right. Now, nobody ever really says that, and I don't suppose you really expect that of me, but the truth is that as a pastor, you think people would think, well, the pastor, he should have it right because he's listening to God and he's doing what he's supposed to do, and therefore he should have heard from God that we weren't going to start on July 5th. Nobody has said this to me. I doubt very seriously but I feel it. You know what I'm saying? So bear with me as I talk this through, but I just the idea that people would think that maybe I don't hear from the Lord just kind of troubled me too. And so there I was Thursday night, just feeling kind of miserable. So in a small way, a very small way, I feel like David and his men getting back from a victorious time, to come to some smoldering ruins in my life and a wave of disappointment that hit me pretty hard. So anyway, I had to write a whole new sermon for this weekend because it doesn't matter why, but I just had to write a whole new sermon. And the time that I needed to put together this video sermon with all of the other things that we usually do, all that time was gone. So here we are. But the Lord's going to use this, I trust, in your life as you listen. So we all face things like this from time to time. Some are hit harder than others, but when you're in the middle of it, it feels like you got punched in the gut. Now, for David and his men, we can just imagine how something like this would be. They are exhausted. They come home. They're coming over the last hill, if you will, to see their town with expectations of to their community, to be greeted by their happy children, to be greeted by their, in this case, their wives. Because they were the men that were in the battle, and they were expecting maybe to come home and have a fresh meal together with their community. If the men were probably expecting maybe to come home and have intimacy with their wives after being gone for a long time. I mean, there's a lot of expectations as you're coming home after a long trip. And I can just imagine the kind of devastation that they feel when they arrive and none of these expectations are met. And I'll tell you the truth, unmet expectations are one of the toughest things to deal with in a marriage. And it's tough. Let me bring some application here. We all have trouble when we have expectations that are unmet. It's these unmet expectations that cause our hearts and minds to even wander at times. It's really why we end up in sinful places often, because we begin to feel sorry for ourselves. And at the very least, we could end up despondent or maybe even depressed over things that we thought were going to happen, but they didn't happen. Or the place that we're at in life, we get to and we realize, I thought it would be different than this. And like David's men, when things are not as we imagine, we begin to lash out. We begin to try to blame others and put fault on others. And you hear it in our nation right now. It's Trump's fault. It's Inslee's fault. It's China's fault. It's my boss's fault. It's my pastor's fault. It's my spouse's fault. And on and on and on we go. We become bitter in spirit and we think we're battling against flesh and blood, but we're not. But we're not. Now, I have an answer for all this, and we're not going to like it. We don't like to hear this, but it is an answer. It is the answer that Scripture gives from Galatians 2:20. It says, I've been crucified with Christ, and I no longer live, but Christ lives in me. And the life I live in the body, I live by faith in the Son of God who gave his life for me. And I'm telling you today that this is the answer to the dilemma of unmet expectations, it is to die to them. If I no longer live, then how can I expect anything? How do I expect anything if I'm truly no longer living? And so there's nothing to expect. It's easy. No expectations, no disappointments. And so I encourage you to think about that. And this is why Jesus told us, take up your cross daily. There needs to be a death to the expectations and the things we think we deserve or want. And then when good things do come our way, we can just praise God and bless Him and love Him and thank Him for all the goodness that comes to our lives, you know, and we don't have to fret over the things that we're getting bombarded by. And so I hope that's helpful, but let's continue with this story a bit. It says in 1 Samuel 30, verses 9 through 10, David and the 600 men with him came to the Besor Valley, where some stayed behind. 200 of them were too exhausted to cross the valley, but David and the other 400 continued the pursuit. Listen to me. We all understand what physical exhaustion is. Our bodies can only take so much. Thank God He set a cycle in our lives, and I hope, you know, I pray for you that you get good sleep, but we have this cycle of daily spending time resting and rejuvenating our bodies. We get that, but a lot of times it's difficult to recognize emotional exhaustion that we're in, and we don't understand why we're feeling the way we are, but we're in this place of emotional exhaustion. And even if we could recognize it, a lot of times we might even think, well, it's weak to give in to that kind of fatigue or to try to do anything about it, but you should just buck up and suck it up, you know, get after it. Well, so these 600 men that had followed David were used to walking and traveling long distances, and no doubt they had physical fatigue, but they were used to this. And they had just fought battles, and now they've walked for 3 days to get home, and they were physically exhausted. But the toll that was really taken upon them was the grief that they experienced. And these, again, these unmet expectations were the least of their troubles at this point. They were drained. They began to lash out at David. Can we just be honest enough to say that we get drained emotionally from time to time? We're all juggling things in life. We're all trying to keep everything going. And we need to recognize that a great deal of exhaustion is not necessarily from the physical, but the emotional. We also need to recognize that we're in different places in our church. Some, like the 400, are ready to go and continue the battle and continue to the fight. But others, maybe like the 200, need rest. They just need to back off. They need to just be encouraged and to sit on the edge of that ravine and just wait it out. And ultimately, we have God as our source of strength, whatever group you're in. But I want you to know today, we will see a victory. We will see a victory. So David and the 400 find an Egyptian slave as they are walking to try to, you know, they're following the footsteps of the horde that has stolen their families. And they find this Egyptian slave that was left behind by these raiders, and he leads them to where these Amalekites are. And so we're going to pick this up in verse 16. He led David down, and there they were, scattered all over the countryside, eating and drinking and reveling because of the great amount of plunder they had taken from the land of the Philistines and from Judah. David fought them from dusk until the evening of the next day, and none of them got away except 400 young men who rode off on camels and fled. David recovered everything the Amalekites had taken, including his two wives. Nothing was missing, young or old, boy or girl, plunder or anything else they had taken. David brought everything back. He took all the flocks and the herds, and his men drove them ahead of the other livestock, saying, "This is David's plunder." Man, what an incredible turn of events. And what a blessing from the Lord. I love it that David recovers everything. No one was missing. Nothing was missing. But not only that, we see now that they're also plundering those Amalekites that had stolen these things from them. And now they're getting their flocks and their herds and all the other plunder that they had. So it all starts to work out. But there's still one more hurdle they need to cross. So we need to keep reading. 1 Samuel 30, 21 through 25 says, "Then David came to the 200 men that had been too exhausted to follow him and who were left behind in the Besor Valley. They came out to meet David and the men with him. As David and his men approached, they asked them how they were. But all the evil men and troublemakers among David's followers said, 'Because they did not go out with us, we will not share with them the plunder we recovered. However, each man may take his wife and children and go.' David replied, 'No, my brothers, you must not do that with what the Lord has given us. He has protected us and delivered into our hands the raiding party that came against us. Who will listen to what you say? The share of the man who stayed with the supplies is to be the same as that of him who went down to the battle. All will share alike.'" Now, we can understand why the 400 might feel this way. They did all the work. They battled. They were the ones who no doubt had cuts on them and different kinds of bruises from the battle and more exhaustion on top of exhaustion. But David's response is what makes him a man after God's own heart. Hear this today. God's heart for us is that even when we haven't got much fight in us, God is for us, and He will not withhold anything from us. Did you hear what I just said? God will not withhold even times when you feel exhausted, when you feel broken down, when you feel like you can't go on. Trust me, the share of those who stay behind with the stuff is the same as those who go to battle. It's a wonderful thing. Now, honestly, I have no idea what the percentage is, but I can't help but wonder if at any time in the church that maybe about two-thirds of the people are ready for battle and another third are probably thinking, I don't know, I'm just hurting right now. But whatever situation you're in, we need to have a good attitude. If you are ready for a battler, but you see others who aren't battling, we can't have a bad attitude towards them. We have to be gracious and encouraging in what we do. And so we've got to have each other's back. We've got to be ready for the fight and to fight the good fight as often as we can, because if there are no fighters, there's no victory, and our families will stay captive. So think about that and consider it. Now, let me wrap this up. It's, again, a little bit of a different week and a shorter message, I think. But let me wrap this all up. This last week was indeed difficult for me. But as I hear what others are going through, I feel silly for complaining, to be quite honest. Even so, we all need to be encouraged from time to time. And Paul addresses this in 1 Thessalonians 5:11-15. He says, therefore, encourage one another and build each other up, just as in fact you are doing. Now we ask you, brothers and sisters, to acknowledge those who work hard among you, who care for you in the Lord and who admonish you. Hold them in the highest regard in love because of their work. Live in peace with each other. And we urge you, brothers and sisters, warn those who are idle and disruptive. Encourage the disheartened, help the weak, be patient with everyone. Make sure that nobody pays back wrong for wrong, but always strive to do what is good for each other and for everyone else. Can I ask you please to take time, even if you're in another city watching this, wherever you are, to take some time this week to reach out to some of the people you haven't heard from in a while and bring some encouragement into their lives. I'm asking you, Praise Center, if you're part of Praise Center, would you just go through maybe your contacts list and look for, let the Lord speak to you about who you might want to call or even text a word of encouragement to. Let's make this week, this first full week of July here, a week that is going to be a week of encouragement to all of the people in our church and in our community. Let's do that. Now, that verse I just read, Paul describes three groups of people, especially in verse 14. He mentions the idle. There's those who are idle and they refuse to work or fight because they're lazy. These people are, it says they're also disruptive. There's no excuse for this. And if we're not fighting the battle just because we're lazy and being disruptive, these people need to be warned to stop stirring things up. There's no excuse for that. But then he says also there are the disheartened. These are guys that are sitting on the edge of the ravine. This is the 200. These are people who have limited or diminished motivation for the attainment of some goal. It's faint-hearted or discouraged. These are the people that we are to comfort for sure. So there's some you need to warn. There's some you need to comfort. And then there's another group that he mentions here that are the weak. This can be physical or emotional weakness. And these people, he says, we're to help. And so we need to do that. And finally, he wraps it all up. And just in case we wanted to use an excuse to not be loving and not be encouraging, he says, basically, just be patient with everybody. Just be patient with everybody. Listen, we need community. We need together. We need church. We really do. And we need to be with each other. So as Paul said, always strive to do what is good for each other and for everyone else. Let's do that. Now, as a pastor, I'm telling you that I need you to have my back. I need you to pray for me and for my family. But I need you to know also that I have your back as well. At times we're all ready to go into battle, but sometimes we're sitting on the edge of the ravine thinking, man, I'm just discouraged. I need encouragement and help. But we will see a victory. We will. The battle is the Lord's. It may take time. It may take effort, but we will come out of this victorious. Now, if we have any strength right now, We need to go right to the camp of the enemy and take back what he stole from us. And it's time to get our families back. Some of you have families that have been broken up by all kinds of things. It's time to get our health back. It's time to take authority in Jesus' name over lost health, maybe this virus or other things that are going on. Let's take our health back. It's time to get our kids back. Some have kids that are wandering from the faith and aren't following the Lord, or they're in rebellion of some sort or another, or they're off in some drugs or whatever. Let's get them back. Let's go into battle for each other right now and get our kids back. It's time to get our stuff back. The enemy has stolen from us and taken things that he has no right to keep. And we're going to go back and get those things. And it's time, can I also say, it's time to get our time back, because the devil can steal time from us, but God can stop the sun in the middle of the sky for us and make it day as long as he wants to. So it's time to get our time back too. And not only that, not only are we getting all that stuff back, but we're going to walk away with plunder from the things that the enemy has stolen. We're going to begin to plunder the enemy as we do that. Let's get into battle mode. But here's one thing more I want to say, is that not only are we going to get stuff back for ourselves, but we're going to get stuff back for others, and we're going to start sharing with one another. And even for those whose strength is failing or feeling weak, in the name of Jesus Christ, we're going to get stuff for them too. We're going to get things back because we're going to contend in prayer. Let me finish with this text right here, 2 Corinthians 10, 3 through 4. For though we live in the world, we do not wage war as the world does. The weapons we fight with are not the weapons of this world. On the contrary, they have divine power to demolish strongholds. Church, can I just tell you, our greatest weapons are prayer, worship, praising God, and using the Word of God. Let's use all those things that are at our disposal to win this war that we're in right now against the enemy, to win back what is for us. We are going to have a victory in Jesus' name. Do you agree? Amen, amen. Well, I hope you have a fantastic week. God bless you. Until we meet again, see you soon.